Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our producer and engineer, the outstanding Mr. Aaron Zommer is on the board. Welcome in. It is Monday, January 22nd, 2024, 6 minutes now past the hour of 12 noon. Great to be back with you live here in the studio, high atop State Street, a block off the Capitol Square in Madison, Wisconsin. And many thanks to our friend, our colleague, the Lukester, Luke Mathers, our executive producer for Civic Media, for holding down the fort and being in the guest host chair on Friday along with Mr. Zommers. Great job, you guys.
Yeah, it was fun. We carried on some of the conversation you had started on Wednesday briefly at the end of the show about Americans' true perception of the economy and how, you know what, maybe things aren't terrible, right, but that doesn't mean that we just sit back on our laurels and be like, all right, things are great.
Right. No, great job. I did not get to listen to the whole thing. I was flying at the time that you guys were on the air, but I'm going to go back and listen too. So thank you very much to you. Thank you very much to Luke Mathers for being here on Friday and filling in. I was out in beautiful Colorado, took a day on Friday, and went out there and saw my good friends, Joe Berkland and his lovely wife, Rachel. And they've been out there for a while. They are doctors, both of them, doctors of physical therapy. So I got to hang with a couple of doctors for the weekend. But it was great. Got to decompress a little bit. Got some good walks in. And I hesitate to tell you specifically where I'm at or where I was at for one reason. I don't want too many people to move there and spoil it.
Good point.
I was at Fort Collins. They live in Fort. It's about an hour north of Denver, Fort Collins, Colorado. I'd never been there before. And I was super impressed with all the cool independent shops, the artwork, the little microbreweries, the distilleries, the chocolate shops, the little restaurants. We saw Book of Mormon, the national tour was there at the Lincoln Center in Fort Collins, a great performance. And just probably maybe my favorite part of the whole weekend was just sitting, making homemade pizza and having, you know, a nice bottle of wine and talking.
Oh, yeah. I know when I visited Colorado, I've been there once because one of my roommate from college, Ethan, lives there. That's where he's from.
Oh, nice.
And so I got to go and visit his house and hang out with him and his family. And from their back porch, you just go out on, they have a little deck, and you can see the mountains from there. Yeah. And just sitting out there and hanging out was so much fun. And then also, of course, if you like hiking, Colorado's the place to be.
We did some hiking. It was beautiful. Actually, warmer out in Colorado than it is here. And they have a couple of beautiful labradoodles. So we hung out with them as well. They were the great guys. So it was fantastic. So many thanks to them. And I want to do a show from Colorado at some point.
That'd be fun.
I think that'd be a lot of fun. The flight home was fine, technically, but got home a little late. And so I'm running on about 3.5 hours of sleep. So if I sound a little punchier than usual, everyone, that's the point here. A lot of big news, though, to get back into it today. And by the way, I'm here, then I'm gone. I'm going to be out tomorrow. Nothing wrong. Just I'm going to be out doing a little family business tomorrow. So our friend Trigvi Olson from the Lincoln Project, who is here every Wednesday, is here in Madison this week. And he is going to be here in this studio with Mr. Zommers guest hosting. He has a couple of big guests. Joe Trippi and Stuart Stevens are lined up tomorrow. Your calls as well. So Trigvi Olson will be in the guest host chair tomorrow. And then we will join you on Wednesday from Wausau in Bull Falls, Radio Land, and then back here on Thursday and Friday. So an active week indeed. An active day today. You may have heard on Matt Nair on the air right before our show, Stuart J. Waddles joined Jane Matt Nair and Greg Bach. Stuart is standing by live in Big Bend, Big Bend, Wisconsin, at the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades District Council 7. In Big Bend in Waukesha County, as Vice President Kamala Harris is in town, and she is marking the 51st anniversary of the Roe decision as she kicks off her Fight for Reproductive Freedom tour. So we're going to be joining that speech. We have it up on the screen here. We're going to be taking the audio for you when she, I guess, according to Stuart, somewhere around 1230-ish. But when that happens, we will take that live, and then Stuart is going to join us live on the scene and kind of tell us what's happening there, give us the flavor, the feel of the room. It's a big deal for a couple of reasons. Politically, it's big because, of course, Wisconsin is going to be one of maybe five states that decides the presidential electoral college election this fall. And so you're going to see a lot of politicians in the state between now and November. And number two, it's obviously a huge issue, perhaps one of, if not the issue, for most women who are going to the polls. And that was the Dobbs decision last year overturning Roe v. Wade. I think it will continue to drive elections, the general election, certainly this fall. So good that we pause, reflect, and remember that as well. So we're going to take the vice president when she comes to the dais in Big Bend in Waukesha County a little bit later in this show and join Stuart J. Waddles will join us as well live on the scene there. Other big news over the weekend, we're going to get to this maybe later this hour or certainly next hour. While I was gone over the weekend, I tried to unplug a little bit. But, you know, it's hard just to completely unplug because you want to stay abreast of the news. So when I get back here, I know what's going on. Good old Jay Rothman, the president of the UW system, used the guise of a big Packers game. People were focused on the Packers over the weekend. And, of course, sadly, the Packers lost by a touch or a field goal to the 40. But, you know, no one expected him to go that far. Great potential for the future. But I think it just hurts knowing that I didn't watch the game. We were actually at Book of Mormon while the game was going on. But my friend Joe dialed up the highlights on the streaming services. So we watched all the scoring drives and everything and also the fumbles. And I think what was frustrating is that the Packers could have and probably should have won that game.
Oh, yeah. It was a good game and yeah. It was so close.
By the way, if you can kick field goals, give Brian Gutekunst a call because he's looking for a kicker. So let us. But anyway, Jay Rothman knew that this was an obviously this part is a little tongue in cheek here, but he knew there was a Packer game, I think, and he knew people's minds would be focused on that cold weather. People weren't really paying attention. So over the weekend, making news in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel and other places. But in my opinion, not covered as much as it should be.
Absolutely not.
Headline, UW Green Bay Marinette ending in-person classes after spring semester. So this time, Jay Rothman, he's had enough, you understand. He's already closed three campuses in Wisconsin. He got in trouble with the governor of the Board of Regents over DEI. And then he had a chancellor of the cross making porn, and he had to fire him. So Jay Rothman has not had a good year, you understand. And he said, look, I'm going to put somebody else out there to walk the plank. And he chose the chancellor at Green Bay, Mike Alexander, who's out there peddling this stuff, saying it's not the end. Quote, we are not leaving. We'll get more into that a little bit later in the show. But yes, a fourth University of Wisconsin system campus is now being shuttered.
And that is absolutely infuriating.
It's terrible.
It might not sound like it from my voice, but right. I am...
Well, because we're getting into the surreal, right? We're getting into the surreal now. And again, a year and a half ago, when they closed Richland, we were there on the ground with a live three-hour show, talking to people on the ground, and I said at the time, this is the canary in the coal mine. This is coming. And almost everybody scoffed. And here we are a year and a half later. And I'm sad to say I was right.
Yeah. And I remember you rattling off a bunch of the smaller campus names. And so far, one by one, they're getting ticked off.
Yeah.
And I think
no joy in this of being right, by the way.
Oh, absolutely.
And I'm not saying I'm smarter than other people. It's just that I had a unique experience and unique insight into this. So I kind of could see what was coming. But we'll get more into that in hour two. Other big news, of course, over the weekend with the New Hampshire primary coming up tomorrow, the race is down essentially to two people. Nikki Haley, former United Nations ambassador and governor of North Carolina, and also or pardon me, South Carolina, and also the former president, Donald Trump, as Ron DeSantis pulled out. He also ended his presidential campaign. But anyway, Ron DeSantis said he is suspending his presidential campaign, not going to move forward, can't see a pendant. How pathetic is this? You can't even wait 24 hours for New. I mean, I guess he didn't want to be humiliated in New Hampshire.
He's been humiliated enough. Well, like, honestly, I think it would be hard for him to disgrace himself more.
Right. But here's the thing he wanted to do. He wanted to make sure that he got in an endorsement for the Trumpster before the election. Do we have time for the Kiss the Ring segment? Here is good old Ron DeSantis. How long ago was this, Mr. Somers?
So let's see. This was January 14th he said this. So seven, eight days ago.
7, 8 days ago, this is what Ron DeSantis had to say.
He cares about. You can be the most worthless Republican in America, but if you kiss the ring, he'll say you're wonderful. You can be the strongest, most dynamic, successful Republican and conservative in America, but if you don't kiss that ring, then he'll try to trash you. You know what? You deserve a nominee that's going to put you first, not himself first.
And less than 2 weeks later, what did Ron DeSantis do? He kissed the ring. He bowed down. He genuflected. And he kissed. He not only suspended his campaign, but he immediately endorsed Donald Trump for president of the United States. It's appalling. And it shows, quite frankly, and we're going to go through some of this. We have more cuts for you of other Republicans. Because remember what people were saying a year ago or 6 months ago? What we need, said the experts, what we need is for Republicans to coalesce around one alternative candidate, because too many candidates are going to spread this out, and Trump, and we can stop Trump if Republicans only coalesce around one candidate. That will end it. Republicans are not crazy. That's what the experts told us. You heard it here on this program from Trigvi Olson and others that said Donald Trump's going to be the nominee. And now we're down to only one candidate, Nikki Haley. And what are Republicans, mainstream Republicans, doing? They are coalescing around one candidate. It's Donald J. Trump. The Republican Party is MAGA. Make no mistake about that. We'll come back, have cuts for you. Your phone calls as well, 844-967-2789. Wiskel Paul joins us on the other side, and your calls as well. It's the Todd Allball Show. We're back live on a Monday on the Civic Media Radio Network. Wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. And it's 20 now past the hour of 12 noon on Monday, January 22nd, 2024. Mr. Somers on the board taking your phone calls. We are standing by. We are going to take at least the first parts of the comments by Vice President Kamala Harris live. She is at the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades, District Council 7. In Big Bend, Wisconsin, in Waukesha County in southeast Wisconsin. We have our newsman, Stuart J. Waddles, standing by live. We're going to take the comments of the vice president, at least part of them, and then we'll go to Stuart and kind of help set the scene, the flavor of the room. So when that happens, Mr. Somers is diligently monitoring that, and we will go to that live. Right now, talking about the news over the weekend, Ron DeSantis suspending his campaign. It's essentially down to Trump versus Haley for the Republican nomination. Polls showing that Haley is down well over double digits. And meanwhile, after Republicans telling us 6 months, a year ago, all it's going to take is for Republicans to coalesce around one alternative candidate and we'll stop Trump because we're not the party of Trump. We want to look forward, they said. We don't want to rehash 2020, they said. We're the party of the future, they said. And now over the weekend, Ron DeSantis and others, which we will tell you about, genuflecting to the altar of Donald Trump and endorsing him. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Let's go to Wisco Paul. Wisco, thanks for standing by. What say you?
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Todd. Right off the top, I didn't think anybody could run a worse campaign than Scott Walker. But...
right? Are you there, Wisco? Hello, Wisco Paul. Wisco Paul?
Must have lost connection.
Yep. Wisco, if you can hear us, stand by. Give us a call back, Wisco, if you can hear us. Always happy to hear from Wisco Paul, probably just going through a bad cell phone area. So give us a call back, Wisco, and finish your thought. But he's absolutely right. You know, Scott Walker ran a pretty terrible campaign for president. But you look at the money that Ron DeSantis spent, and quite frankly, someone said this on socials over the weekend. I can't remember who it was, or I give him credit. But they said, you know, it's easy to make fun of a campaign like Ron DeSantis, and then you think of all the harm and hurt that he did to people, from the book bannings, to attacking Disney, to attacking LGBTQ people, to, you know, hoodwinking migrants and immigrants into buses and planes and dropping them off in the dead of cold. All of this for cheap political gain. All right. And then it becomes not so funny. But Wisco's absolutely right. If you didn't think there could be a worse presidential campaign than Scott Walker, take a look at Ron DeSantis. 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Wisco, must have been some bugs in the system there, but glad you called back. But you're right. If you didn't think you have a worse campaign than Scott Walker, look at Ron DeSantis. What else you got for us?
Yeah, the only other thing, and I'm on a cell phone, so sometimes you lose contact. But
no worries.
If somebody Trump trashed Ted Cruz, even trashed his wife, and he's made up all his nicknames for people, but, I mean, it's like trashing you. I mean, he's right, calling you names and mocking you. Are you going to support somebody like that? I mean, that's just, as you said before, are you going to kiss his ring? I mean, I'm certainly not. If I'm Ted Cruz and somebody says I think it was his father helped assassinate Kennedy and
yeah,
your wife is ugly or whatever else he
yeah
said, I'm not going to support this guy. And I, you know, it's a sad day that the Republican Party is going the Trump way. I mean, I have no control over it, but it's a sad day because we need two viable political parties. Well, anyway, thanks for putting up with my cell phone,
no,
Todd, and have a great day.
Hey, you as well, Wisco. Thanks for calling. No, absolutely. We always appreciate the call. Not a problem at all. Totally understand. In Wisconsin, of course, we don't always have, consistent cell phone coverage, but we appreciate folks calling when they can. Wisco brings up this point, and he's 100% right on this, is that Ted Cruz, Senator Ted Cruz from Texas, who Wisco's right, called Ted Cruz's wife ugly and a bad person. I said that Cruz's father was in on the Kennedy assassination. Claimed that Cruz wasn't eligible to be president because he was born in Canada. Same thing as he's going after Nikki Haley. Birther stuff. And yet Ted Cruz bows down and again endorses Trump in 2024. Marco Rubio.
Little Marco.
Little Marco.
To go with the point about the nicknames.
Right. Made fun of his small hands. A short guy. Little Marco, Trump called him. Demoralizing. Made fun of him.
And now Rob DeSanctimonious.
Yeah, Rob DeSanctimonious. Ron DeSanctimonious. That's what, you know, Trump ridiculed him. So Cruz, Rubio, DeSantis, all bowing down to kiss the ring. Lindsey Graham, who said that Trump was a threat to democracy in 2016. Once again in 2024, like he did in 2020, kissing the ring. Gonna have time for a couple more of these cuts and by the way, we're standing by, gonna be taking Kamala Harris, Vice President Kamala Harris. She is in Wisconsin in Big Bend and is gonna be addressing folks on the 51st anniversary of the Roe decision, women's reproductive rights. We're gonna go to that as soon as she gets to the dais here. But let's hear from another former opponent in this primary, U.S. Senator Tim Scott, one of the few black Republicans in Congress who said some pretty stark things about Trump on the campaign trail. But here's what he had to say about Trump this weekend.
President, we need a president who will unite our country. We need Donald Trump. We need a president who will protect your Social Security and my mama's Social Security. We need Donald Trump. We need a president today who will stop the crime and recklessness in the streets. We need a president who will restore law and order. We need Donald Trump.
All right, that's the line I wanted to get to. We need a president who will restore law and order. Quote, we need Donald Trump, unquote, Tim Scott. This is a guy, Trump, 91 criminal indictments. 91 criminal indictments. Has been found liable for sexual assault. And you're going to say that's the guy to restore law and order.
The guy who also explicitly is trying to get law and order for the president removed.
Right. Who thinks that presidents should have complete immunity. And if you think this is just other places and not Wisconsin, Derek Van Orten, the Republican congressman from Western Wisconsin's 3rd District, was down in Iowa endorsing him, campaigning him, and has been active on the socials. This guy is on the Trump train. Crazy knows no bounds. Back with more after this. Don't go anywhere. It's the Todd Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Tunnelball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 12:34 on a Monday afternoon, January 22nd, 2024. Glad to be back with you along with Mr. Zommers. What did you dial up there, Mr. Zommers?
Got a little Criminal by Fiona Apple. Since we're talking about Donald Trump, I just thought it might be
a little apropos.
I don't know. It popped in my head. I can't think of any connection to the topic. But
by the way, we are waiting right now, monitoring what's going on down in West Bend. Pardon me. I keep saying that. I get my Big Bends and my West Bends mixed up. Big Bend, Wisconsin, is where Vice President Kamala Harris is. She is set to speak at the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades District Council 7 at Big Bend. She is marking the 51st anniversary of the Roe decision. And, of course, overturning that decision last year, the Dobbs decision by the U.S. Supreme Court. She is in Wisconsin to kick off her Fight for Reproductive Freedoms tour with her speech in Waukesha County today. We will go live to that and take part of that shortly as soon as she gets to the dais there, and also check in with our newsman, Stuart J. Waddles, who is in the room and on the ground. He will tell us kind of what the flavor is down there and what folks are talking about as the vice president visits Wisconsin today. We'll go to that as soon as it happens. Right now, though, we are continuing to talk about news over the weekend. Ron DeSantis suspending his campaign, the Republican governor of Florida, as we are on the eve of the New Hampshire caucuses. And for all intent and purposes, the race is down to Trump versus Nikki Haley. And this is what Republicans told us. The so-called experts told us a year ago, 6 months ago, they said, well, just wait. You know, Republicans, they need to narrow the field and get it down to one alternative to Trump. And when that happens, they said, you'll see mainstream Republicans coalesce around that alternative candidate and Trump won't make it to the nomination. Instead, what is happening as the field narrows, more and more people are jumping over themselves to endorse Donald Trump. DeSantis, the latest amongst them, this weekend. In the same speech where he suspended his presidential campaign, his own campaign, he endorses Trump. So too, Did U.S. Senator Tim Scott, also a former opponent, primary opponent of Trump this time around, he follows people like Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio, Lindsey Graham, and others who are all in on Trump. Here in Wisconsin, Derek Van Orten, Republican congressman from Wisconsin, Scott Fitzgerald, Republican congressman from Wisconsin, all in on the Trump train. 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Let's go to the phones. Jay, across the pond, over in London. Jay, as always, thanks for listening in. What say you?
Welcome back. The kids, they did behave on Friday, okay?
Well, very good. I'm sure they did fine. And Trigby's in tomorrow, so we're all in good hands. What do you got for us today, Jay?
I'll go tomorrow. You see, what worries me about is the, what is them, the normal ones, they are endorsing Trump. All of them are lining up. And this has will give permission to people who are like, okay, you know what, he's not that bad.
Exactly.
You can support him.
Exactly.
This is very bad, Trump.
No, Jay hits on something here, and I agree with you 100%. She's saying that with all these people lining up and endorsing Trump, it normalizes it. It makes it sound like he's just another normal candidate for president. And it's funny you say this, Jay. Yeah. It's funny you say this because I flew, you may have heard I was in visiting friends out in Colorado this weekend, and I flew out of Milwaukee. By the way, a great airport. I stopped by the Dan Schaefer recombobulation area after I got I got through TSA. But anyway, I flew out of Milwaukee, and I was, of course, in Milwaukee on Thursday for the state education convention. And there's already promotion right now for the Republican National Convention this summer in Milwaukee. And to your point, Jay, I got thinking about this. And I'm like, we're just going down this road of like everything's normal. Like this is just another normal year. And it's not, right?
Presidential one. Todd, we are horrified here. We are looking at, like, it's horrific what's going on. The capitals of Berlin, London, everyone is horrified by this. Our top diplomats here, they are sounding the alarm. How is it a danger to the alliance? I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. Well, I really appreciate it. I think you heard last week we had my friend Kristen Jensen, who is a former member of parliament in Denmark and the former minister of foreign affairs in Denmark. And he's saying exactly what you're saying, that diplomats across.
I listened to you and him. Okay.
He's a great guy. And again, he's not some left-wing politician. He's a center-right European politician. And he is saying that leaders in the European Union are extraordinarily nervous about democracy and about these elections in the United States.
Did you see what's happening in Germany? The protest that is happening against the fascist movement there?
And where?
People have had enough. Thousands of people. Germany.
Oh, Germany. Yes, right. No, I mean it's raising its head everywhere, and it's disturbing. Yeah. Jay, always a pleasure. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate your calls. Have a great day over there across the pond. A great evening, I should say, as they're about 6-7 hours ahead of us. If you'd like to join the discussion, welcome your phone calls, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789, as we await Vice President Kamala Harris going to the dais at Big Bend in southeast Wisconsin, Waukesha County. Stuart J. Waddles, our news person there, standing by. We will go to the Vice President as soon as she begins to speak. Off the text line, by the way, you can also text us if you don't want to call. Download the Civic Media app on your Apple or Android device. It's easy and quick to do. Won't cost you a dime. The Civic Media app off the text line. Andrew from Maine listening in via WAUK, the Shaw in Waukesha, where the vice president is at in Waukesha County. Andrew says, do you think we can convince Republicans to support Richard Nixon instead of Trump? He didn't get to finish his second term, and the Constitution makes no mention of the person being alive. Well, I'm sure that's tongue-in-cheek, but here's something more serious that Andrew also added in. He says, do you think DeSantis might be hoping for the vice president bid by kissing up to Trump so he can be president without having to run, unquote? Sure. I think there's a lot of people that want to be vice president, DeSantis amongst them, Tim Scott, certainly. And in addition to endorsing Trump, Tim Scott announced that he's engaged over the weekend to a woman. And I'll simply say, congratulations. Raise some eyebrows. I'll simply say that. So, God love him, but all these people are doing things in their professional private lives to line up and try to be the bride to a Trump presidency.
And when you played the clip of Tim Scott, you did hear some people chanting in the background, VP, VP.
Oh, yeah. No, it's all about VP. I don't think that either DeSantis or Tim Scott or Nikki Haley, none of them are going to be VP.
No, they've stood against him for too long.
Right. I think it's going to be someone who's been kissing his rear end for the entire time. Somebody like Elise Stefanik in leadership in the House Republican Caucus at one time was considered a reasonable, thoughtful conservative. Remember, Elise Stefanik is who Republicans put in the leadership position in the third position after they kicked Liz Cheney out. And from that moment forward, Elise Stefanik has slowly been changing her act. And now this weekend on the news programs, Elise Stefanik defending Donald Trump in the E. Jean Carroll lawsuit. Here's what she had to say this weekend. Here is Elise Stefanik.
President Trump has a problem. How do you think his side while a jury is debating how much to award E. Jean Carroll for being sexually abused by Donald Trump?
These are witch hunts against President Trump, whether it's the
you don't believe E. Jean Carroll.
Whether it's the Bluegate case, Tish James, who is a radical, they're all witch hunts against President Trump.
The jury found that Donald Trump
said they are all witch hunts against President Trump, and the reason why is because he's pulling ahead of Joe Biden, and Joe Biden is the weakest candidate we've ever seen. No, I disagree. No, I don't.
So there was, let's jump out of it. That's my bad. I found that clip, but I didn't know there was so much noise, crowd noise behind it. In case you couldn't hear, and that's my bad, the reporter was asking Elise Stefanik, what do you think about this lawsuit right now happening or this trial right now with E. Jean Carroll, the woman who accused Donald Trump of sexual assault. And he was, in fact, because time has passed, it couldn't be a criminal case, In the civil case to find out whether he was liable, a jury has already convicted and said yes, that you can't technically use the term guilty because it's not a criminal case, is my understanding from Matt Flynn and others who are attorneys. So the verbiage is he was found liable.
But it's the equivalent.
But it's the equivalent of being found guilty in a criminal trial. So he's been found liable already. And the reporter said, what do you think? And Elise Stefanik just simply calls it, quote, a witch hunt.
Oh, it's the media. The media are doing this.
Right. And the reporter says, reminds Elise Stefanik that, in fact, he has already been found liable. And she wouldn't relent. And she says, it's a witch hunt. And it's only because Trump is doing better in the polls against Biden.
Right. They specified, this is not the media. It was a jury of her peers and his peers right. Who found this. And then she just didn't respond to that and just kept talking about the media.
So Elise Stefanik is all on board the Trump train as well. So I think it will be, I think the vice president, if I had to lay odds today, I'm not going to say one person, but I think it's going to be an Elise Stefanik, Kristi Noem, the governor from, is it South Dakota, North Dakota, I think. Or also, I know people are poo-pooing this. I think Marjorie Taylor Greene still has a shot because Trump loves crazy and he loves being, worshipped.
She has never stepped out of line. And she, I think another thing, maybe Donald Trump has a foot fetish because she puts her foot in her mouth about as much as he puts his foot in his mouth.
Of all his fetishes, I never thought of that one, but you might have a good point there, Mr. Somers. Very, very well done. 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789, as we await the words or the remarks by Vice President Kamala Harris. She is in Big Bend, Wisconsin, at the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades District Council 7, marking the 51st anniversary of Roe v. Wade. She is kicking off her fight for Reproductive Freedom's tour here in Wisconsin. And as politicians do, I think running a little bit late. So as soon as we get her, we will go live there. Also, Stuart J. Waddell standing by as well, live on the scene from Civic Media News. We will go to him as well. Do we have time for the let's give one of these clips? Do we have time for the January 6th clip against Haley there? Blame me. So this is I want to give you a little taste of what all these Republicans are endorsing. Just remind us all what this guy is actually saying. Here's what he had to say about January 6th and who is in charge of security on January 6th at the Capitol. Here's the Trumpster.
Never reports the crowds, you know. By the way, they never report the crowd on January 6th. You know, Nikki Haley, you know, they destroyed all of the information, all of the evidence, everything, deleted and destroyed all of it, because of lots of things. Like Nikki Haley is in charge of security. We offered her 10,000 people.
So there's Trump making the charge that Nikki Haley, what he meant to say is Nancy Pelosi. And there's a whole thing going on social, a big discussion about Trump's own mental health and memory, thinking that Nikki Haley was in charge of security. What he meant to say was Nancy Pelosi. Adam Kinzinger, former Republican congressman, former active duty military, a veteran Republican congressman who was there on January 6th, who lost a primary because he had the audacity to vote in favor of the second Trump impeachment. Here, Adam Kinzinger heard that and he tweeted out, guess who's in charge of the Washington, D.C. National Guard? Wait for it. Donald J. Trump was in charge, because the president, not the mayor, not, you know, there's no governor in the District of Columbia. The president's in charge of them, of the National Guard. It's just a big lie. More on the other side. It's the Todd Allbull Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Truth, wherever it may lead, and having fun doing it. Welcome back to the Todd Allbull Show on Civic Media. 10 now before the hour of 1 o'clock. I want to bring you some breaking news quickly. Dexter Scott King, according to CBS News, the younger son of Martin Luther King Jr., has died of cancer at the age of 62. Again, Martin Luther King Jr.'s younger son, Dexter Scott King, dead of cancer at the age of 62, regret to inform you of that news, but wanted to bring it to you as soon as we got it. Also, speaking of news, we are awaiting here shortly Vice President Kamala Harris. She is at the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades District Council 7 in Big Bend, Wisconsin. She is here in the state marking the 51st anniversary of Roe v. Wade and kicking off her Fight for Reproductive Freedoms tour with her speech in Waukesha County. Right now, as we're looking live at the feed, courtesy of Wisconsin Eye, we believe she is being introduced right now by, it appears to be a physician. She is wearing a UW Health jacket, and it looks like she's going to be introducing the Vice President of the United States here in Big Bend, Wisconsin. Again, kicking off her Fight for Reproductive Freedoms tour. We look at the stage there. U.S. flags behind the dais. A Wisconsin flag. There we go.
Here's the
Vice President of the United States.
She's walking up the side of the stage.
And these things are always full of pomp and circumstance. Big crowd, it looks like. A nice crowd there in Big Bend. Vice President coming to the dais now. Here is the Vice President of the United States, Kamala Harris.
Oh, it's good to be back in Wisconsin. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Can we please give it up for Dr. Domeyer Klansky for just all she has done and her incredible courage. I had the joy of spending some time with her backstage. You really are fantastic. And of course, it is good to be with my dear friend Tammy Baldwin. She was here earlier today, but she had to go back to Washington for some important votes. And on the subject of Tammy Baldwin, I want to just mention Tammy because she had to go back to Washington for some important votes. She was here earlier. But I will say, Wisconsin, that you have in her an extraordinary leader. I had the privilege of spending time with her when I was in the Senate. Tammy is always fighting for the people of Wisconsin. And so can we please applaud her for what she does? Thank you. And moving on, I want to say that, you know, when we look at where we are as a country, we do need those elected leaders among the leaders who are here. For example, Congresswoman Gwen Moore is here, another member of Congress. And all of the state and local leaders who are here, I want to thank you all for the work that you do to uphold one of our nation's highest ideals, the ideal of freedom. Freedom, I believe, is fundamental to the promise of America. Freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom of assembly, the freedom to vote. In America, freedom is not to be given. It is not to be bestowed. It is ours by right. By right. And that includes the freedom to make decisions about one's own body, not the government telling you what to do. 51 years ago today, in the case of Roe v. Wade, the United States Supreme Court recognized the fundamental constitutional right to reproductive freedom. And for nearly half a century, Americans relied on the freedoms protected by Roe. However, 19 months ago, the highest court in our land, the court of Thurgood and RBG, took a constitutional right from the people of America, from the women of America. And now, on the 51st anniversary of Roe, we speak of it in the past tense. In the last 19 months, in states across our nation, extremists have proposed and passed laws that criminalize doctors and punish women. Laws that threaten doctors and nurses with prison time, even for life, simply for providing health care. Laws that in some states make no exception even for rape and incest. Now, many of you know I started my career as a prosecutor, specializing in crimes against women and children. What you may not know is one of the reasons why. So when I was in high school, I learned that one of my best friends was being molested by her stepfather. And so I said to her, "You got to come stay with us." I called my mother, and my mother said, "Of course she should." And she did. So the idea that someone who survives a crime that is violence to their body, a violation to their body, and then would not have the authority to decide what happens to their body next, that's immoral. It's immoral. And let us all agree, one does not have to abandon their faith or deeply held beliefs to agree, the government should not be telling her what to do with her body.
You've been listening to remarks by Vice President Kamala Harris from Big Bend, Wisconsin, marking the 51st anniversary of Roe v. Wade and also kicking off her Fight for Reproductive Freedoms tour. We have to break here for the top of the hour news, got a little weather as well. We'll come back on the other side, check in with Stuart J. Waddles, who is live in Big Bend. Talk to him a little bit about the vice president being there. Also talking about UW System closing down UW Green Bay Marinette and more on Republicans lining up behind Trump. All of that in hour two, plus your phone calls. Don't go anywhere. It's the Todd Oppel Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.